On First Sundays here at Bethany Baptist Church, we observe the Lord's table. And as we come, we look at it as a memorial, a time to think back on what Christ has done for us. And because Christ died on a cross, that we not only have eternal life, but according to John chapter 10, we can have an abundant life. And so as we come today, we pray that you would allow the reflection upon these elements as we take them to have meaningful significance in your heart as to what Christ has done for you. Let's ask the Lord's blessing on the elements. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to take communion. And Lord, we ask now that you would bless these elements. And even though we know that they don't actually become the body and blood of Jesus Christ, that we see them as a memorial, that they are symbolic of the body and blood of our Lord and Savior. So we ask that you would bless our time as we fellowship at the Lord's table. In Christ's name, amen. The bread that we hold in our hand represents the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This was broken for you. Think about what he went through because he loved us. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, it says that God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. His body was broken for us. And as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of him. This cup represents the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I once heard it said that Jesus shed most of his blood before he came to the cross. Even though he shed a lot of blood on the cross, he shed a lot before he got to the cross. And every drop that he shed works for the redemption of our salvation. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of him. My friends, we are blessed here at Bethany Baptist Church by the faithfulness of the saints in giving. And so we want to take this time to ask the Lord's blessing upon the offering that is given here at Bethany Baptist Church, whether it is online or whether it comes in through the mail. Father, we thank you for the gifts that you have given to this church through your people. And Lord, we ask now that you would continue to use them for your honor and glory. And Lord, that we might see ministry go forth and that we might see saints built up. And Lord, we might see souls saved. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Angel Tree is an outreach to families of men and women who are incarcerated. We reach out in Christ's name and provide each family with a gift card and an individual gift for the children as well. We need individuals that will make a commitment to pray that we will genuinely express the love of God to the families we are serving. We need people to donate money to cover the purchase of $40 Target gift cards. This year we have 32 Angel Tree children. No donation is too small. Checks made out to Bethany Baptist Church should be mailed to 7745 Tioga Street, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, 15208. Write in the Angel Tree on the check memo line. Gifts can be mailed all the way through the end of the year. Contact Mark Corbin if you would like to assist in delivering the gifts to the families. Call him at 412-606-7334. Be a blessing to someone this Christmas. Thank you.
Welcome to the second Sunday on our Advent journey. Last week, we began the journey by focusing on joy in Jesus, the joy of walking in His way. Today, we will stop to explore joy in Jesus, the joy of being transformed.
In the beginning of Luke's gospel, we find two women becoming pregnant through the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit. One in her old age, and one a young virgin. Joy is expressed by both. The connection, the transformation, and the joy they both experienced were because of Jesus.
The good news is that because of Jesus, supernatural transformation can happen in us as well. When we are choosing to walk in His paths, according to His Word, and cooperate with the Holy Spirit in us, we can experience the joy of being transformed from the inside out.
There is a joy in knowing we have the power of the Holy Spirit, always available, guide us, help us deal with whatever in our lives needs to be changed, or redeemed, or totally removed.
It could be doubts or fears, unhealthy desires or thought patterns, blind spots or hidden sins. He knows.
And He knows that true transformation is not without pain and sacrifice, but as we tap into the joy of choosing to walk in His paths.
As we nurture our relationship with Jesus through time spent with Him and in His Word,
and as we make ourselves accountable to others, we are enabled to stand firm in the Lord. Take to heart these words of Paul to his Philippian readers.
Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly wait for a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. He will transform the body of our humble condition into the likeness of His glorious body by the power that enables Him to bring everything under His control. So then, my dearly loved and longed for brothers and sisters, in this manner stand firm in the Lord, my dear friends. Would you please join me in prayer? Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank You for the Advent season, the anticipation that we feel, Lord, as John and Elizabeth, his mom, felt when Mary came to them and the babies leaped in the womb from joy and excitement. Oh, Lord, we feel that as the day draws near. So we thank You, Lord, for sending Your precious gift to us. And we pray, Lord, that through the abundant love that You have shown us, that we will be worthy to be a gift to You. We ask that You will bless Pastor as he brings his inspirational message. And we pray, Lord, that all of those that are hearing and seeing this will reap the joy that this season brings. In the name of our Lord and precious Savior, Jesus our Christ, we pray. Amen.
Joy to the world. Joy to the world. And heaven and nature sing.
prosperity.
Oh, oh, joy to the world. Joy to the world, then we sing.
Let the angel voices ring.
Joy to the world, then we sing.
Let them and their songs employ.
Joy to the world, then we sing. Repeat the sounding joy.
Oh. He rules the world with truth and grace. He makes the nations prove.
And makes the nations prove.
Righteousness and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his
joy to the world that we sing. Let the earth receive her King. Joy to the world that we sing. Let the angel voices ring.
Greetings, saints. This morning, we are going to be talking about the joy of being transformed. The joy of being transformed. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I have sought. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roll, since Jesus came into my heart. This Advent season, we are speaking on the theme, Joy in Jesus. And as we look at the 4 weeks of Advent, we see that last week we talked about the joy of walking in his paths. Today, we are going to talk about the joy of being transformed. Next week, we're going to talk about the joy of generosity. And the Sunday before Christmas, we're going to be dealing with the joy of fulfillment. When we think about the joy in transformation, no transformation can take place unless there's some pain that's found somewhere. I'm reminded of the Incredible Hulk and how that the Incredible Hulk transformed from mild-mannered Bruce Banner into this big green monster. And that was a very painful experience, that there's pain in transformation. And I was talking to my brother because, he knows a lot about these characters. So, you know, he kind of gave me some advice on the Incredible Hulk and the transformation. And one of the things that he told me is that it was a painful experience, that as Bruce Banner changed and was transformed into the Incredible Hulk, that it was very painful. And the more that he fought it, the more pain he experienced. And so he had to come to the place where he realized that what he was doing was for the good of others. And once he realized that and got in his mind that he was doing it for the good of others, as he went through that transformation, that the transformation became less painful. But nevertheless, there was pain in the transformation. We're talking about the joy of transformation this morning. And we can't experience the joy of transformation unless we realize also that there was some pain in transformation. And who experienced that pain? Well, none other than Jesus Christ. When we think about the pain that Jesus went through to bring about our transformation, let me share with you two things. That here we are celebrating Advent, the coming of Christ. We have lit the candles to symbolize the coming of Christ. Now, just before Jesus died on the cross, he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And many theologians believe that Jesus was experiencing the pain of separation from the Father. But let me back up to his birth. And I wonder, now, I don't have any scripture to bear this out. And, you know, this is just my sanctified thought. I wonder when Jesus left the glories of heaven and he knew that he was going to be separated from the Father, from the Father's glory, from the manifest presence of God, that when he stepped out of heaven to come and be born on this earth, when he came as a babe in the manger, I wonder if he experienced the pain of separation. Ah, there can be no transformation unless there's pain. And then we realize that when Jesus died on the cross, that he experienced the pain of dying on the cross. In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2, it says that he endured the cross. He endured the suffering. And so from his birth all the way to his death, we have indications that Jesus experienced the pain of separation, the pain of suffering. And when you think about that, that even when we go back to the Incredible Hulk, is that there's no transformation unless there's some pain. And so Jesus went through the pain. Jesus went through the suffering so that we could be transformed and so that we could experience the joy of transformation. Oh, I love that song that I quoted at the beginning of the service. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I have sought since Jesus came into my heart. That's the transformation, that when Jesus came into our heart, that we were transformed. But then I like the song because it goes on to say, floods of joy, oh, hallelujah. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll since Jesus came into my heart. You see, my brothers and sisters, when Jesus came into our heart, there was a transformation. And then the songwriter kind of slips in this line and says that floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea billows roll since Jesus came into my heart. We are talking about the joy of transformation today. And as I share this message with you, I have three things that I want to say about the joy of transformation. The first is the joy of past transformation. The second is the joy of present transformation. And then the third is the joy of future transformation. Let's unpack this and let's look at the joy of past transformation. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, in verse 17, we read these words. Therefore, if any man or woman be in Christ, he or she is a new creation. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. This is a great transformation. And this transformation took place in the past, that when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there was a great transformation that took place in your life. And what was that transformation? It says that all things were passed away and all things have become new. that the old things that passed away, that I'm no longer a servant of sin. I no longer have this body of death. You know, I heard that in Paul's day, when he talked about bearing this body of death, or this living in this body of death, is that one of the things that would happen when a criminal had been convicted, one of the things that they would do to punish them before they died is that they would actually take a dead body. It may have been the dead body of an animal, or maybe the dead body of another human being, and they would tie that dead body to that individual. And the flesh, the death, all the corruption that was in that dead body would begin to eat away at the person who had that body strapped to him. And so when we think about the transformation that took place, all things passed away. That Christ took off of us that body of death, that body that was eating away at us, that he came, that he was born, and he took away that old sinful nature, and he gave us a new nature. That's reason for rejoicing. The joy of transformation. That I no longer have to bear about in the flesh this body of death, that dead body that was tied to me. But because I've been transformed, that God has cut the bands of that dead body. And now I'm a new creature in Jesus Christ. And I don't know about you, brothers and sisters, but to me, there is joy in that transformation. And we have the new body. We have a new life. We have a new family. We have a new future. That's a transformation. That God has taken me out of that old life and has given me a new life. I heard the story about some dragonflies, and they lived underneath the surface of a pond. And, you know, they were almost like little fish or little tadpoles. And what would happen is that every now and then, one of the little tadpoles or the little fish would climb up a stem and go on the other side of the pond. And this happened quite often, and it bewildered the dragonflies that were underneath the pond, because they didn't know what was happening to their comrades, you know, what was going on. And so they made a pact, and in the pact, they said, the next one of us that makes it to the other side, we want you to come back and tell us what's happening so that we'll know. And wouldn't you know it, shortly after they made that pact, that there was one who climbed up that stem and got on the other side. And as he got on the other side, all of a sudden, it seemed like he went through a death, that he kind of stayed still for a little while. And then all of a sudden, he began to bust out of this cocoon-like substance. And he began to grow wings, and he began to transform into a dragonfly. And he started flying around. And it was just an experience that, you know, he was overwhelming, and he flew around and was flying around. And just about the time he was getting ready to take off and go somewhere else, he remembered the pact that they made, and that the next one that made it out would come back and let the other ones know what had happened. And so he saw the other ones underneath the pond, and he tried his best to come back. He hit the water, and when he hit the water, he bounced off. He tried everything he could to let them know, hey, this is me. But he couldn't get back underneath the surface of the pond to tell him anything. What had happened? His nature had changed. His nature was changed, and he no longer could go back underneath the water. And when we think about us as believers, It says that old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And I thought, man, that's an awesome comparison between the dragonfly and the believer. Three things. The first thing is the dragonfly went through a rebirth, that it changed its nature from being able to live under the water as this creature that lived underneath the pond. Now it was one that was born to fly above the pond. Secondly, the nature of the dragonfly was transformed. And when you think about the believer, Paul said that our natures have been transformed, that old things are passed away and all things become new. And even going back to the first point, the dragonfly goes through a rebirth, and as the believer, we go through a rebirth. Jesus told Nicodemus, except you be born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. So there's a rebirth, there's a transformation, and then, oh, I love this one right here. I love this. And you know, I would to God that God's people get a hold of what I'm getting ready to say. And the third thing about the dragonfly is that the dragonfly could not live where it once lived. Think about that. Let that sink in. The dragonfly could not live where it once lived. It couldn't go back underneath. It wasn't designed to go back underneath the water anymore. Most likely, if it went back underneath the water, it would probably drown. And you think about God's people that have been transformed. Why did Christ come? Yeah, he came to bring us salvation, but he also came to transform our lives. And as believers, we can't, let me put it this way. We shouldn't go back to the way of living that we lived before we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. It's sad to say that some believers, they've gone through this metamorphosis and they've gone back to the same place before where they got saved. And so when we think about the dragonfly and how it can't go back to the place where it was before it was transformed, and as believers, we ought to realize that God has changed us, that God has transformed us, and we can no longer go back to those old sinful places. Oh, you know, stop preaching and gone to meddling now. You know, we can't go back to those old sinful places that we used to go. The joy, I'm talking about the joy of transformation, that Jesus came, the advent, the coming of Christ. He came so that we might be transformed. And that's the past transformation. What about the present transformation? We see that in Romans chapter 12 in verse 2. And be not conformed to this world. But what? Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Notice that he says, be transformed. This is the present transformation. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, that's the past transformation. All things are passed away. All things become new. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, that's the present transformation. And this transformation is interesting. This word transformed actually means metamorphosis. It comes from the Greek word metamorpho, which we get the English word metamorphosis. And so it's saying that you ought to go through a metamorphosis. Every day you ought to go through a metamorphosis. And how do you go through that metamorphosis? You go through that metamorphosis by the renewing of your mind. Woo! Every day when I get up, there ought to be a spiritual transformation that takes place in my life. That I ought to get into this word. And as I get into the word, my mind is renewed and I am transformed. And as this transformation takes place, it not only works in my mind, but it also filters down and it works in my body also. This is what's called the present transformation. Oh, we can rejoice. We can rejoice that we don't have to live every day as a slave to our habits, that we don't have to live as a slave every day to our sins, but by the renewing of our mind, that we can be transformed. I heard a wonderful illustration given, and it talked about the spiritual transformation that we can experience. A preacher by the name of John Ortberg, he had an article, True and False Transformation, in the Leadership Journal of the summer of 2002. And he talked about spiritual transformation as being God's part and being our part. And then he gave this beautiful illustration. He said, some people like to see spiritual transformation, they like to see it like a rowboat, like you're trying to go across the ocean on the rowboat, right? And as you're going across the ocean on the rowboat, man, I tell you what, it's exhausting. You get tired. You know, you're trying to transform yourself every day. You know, you're trying to work at it, and you're trying to have this metamorphosis take place, and you're rowing as hard as you can. And what's going to eventually happen? You're going to get tired, and you're probably going to quit, right? Trying to make that spiritual transformation in a rowboat. And then he said there's the raft, trying to go across the ocean in a raft. And he said, this is where you don't give any energy at all, but you say, okay, well, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to let God take me across. I'm just going to depend on the grace of God to get me across. And I'm just going to drift across the ocean. And so in that, these individuals do nothing, and they just hope and pray that God will get them there. But I like the third analogy that he gave about spiritual transformation. He said that it's a sailboat. And he talked about the sailboat, how the person on the sailboat is dependent on the wind. And all that person has to do is control it when the wind comes. And that's what spiritual transformation is, that we allow the wind of the Holy Spirit to blow in our lives. We get into the Word of God, and as we read the Word of God, and we let the Word of God get into our mind, when the Holy Spirit blows, we're like that sailboat. We just catch the wind of the Holy Spirit, and then we just glide across the ocean in this spiritual transformation. Spiritual transformation. Are you a rowboat? Are you trying to do it on your own? Are you getting exhausted trying to have this spiritual transformation? Are you on a raft? Are you just floating across, saying, well, I'm going to just let God do everything? Or are you a sailboat? Are you catching the wind of the Holy Spirit and allowing the Word of God to guide and direct? This is the joy of the present transformation, that I can have joy in knowing that God is in control and I'm trusting Him, but I'm also putting in me what I need to ride this sail. Ah, the joy of past transformation, 2 Corinthians 5:17, anybody in Christ, a new creation, old things passed away, behold, all things become new. The joy of present transformation, be renewed in your mind. And then I want to close with the joy of future transformation. The joy of future transformation. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20 and 21. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile bodies, that it might be fashioned unto His glorious body, according to the working whereby He is able to subdue all things unto Himself. What a powerful verse. It lets us know that one day these bodies that we live in right now. As a matter of fact, Paul called them vile bodies. What does that mean when he says vile bodies? These bodies that are prone to sickness. These bodies that are prone to illness. These bodies that are prone to decay. These bodies that are prone to disease. These bodies that are eventually prone to die. It says that one day there's going to be a transformation. And I like what the old spiritual, the words of the old spiritual. I looked at my hands and my hands looked new. I looked at my feet and they did too. And that's that future transformation when we enter into the presence of God and we get our glorified bodies. It says that Christ will transform our bodies and shape and fashion them after his glorious body. I remember seeing a commercial about a pen, and an ink pen. And it said, in case of malfunction, put in the box and return to the sender for a new pen. Oh, one day, this old body's gonna break down. And they're gonna have to put it back in the box. And they're gonna have to return it to the sender. And when they return it to the sender, he's gonna give me a new one. That's the greatest transformation that will take place. And just think, when we think about Christmas and we think about the coming of Christ, in our thoughts, there ought to be the joy of transformation. The joy of transformation. The past joy, the present joy, and the future joy. We've all heard the story of how a caterpillar travels along. And I remember on one occasion I was doing some work outside, and I was sawing some wood, and there was sawdust that was on the ground. And I remember seeing the caterpillar crawling through the sawdust. And as the caterpillar crawled through the sawdust, it began to get all the sawdust on the bottom of it, and even got some sawdust on its fur. And just think that that's the way that we are sometimes, that we travel through this world and we pick up the dust of this world. But at some point, that caterpillar goes into the cocoon. And in the cocoon, there's a great struggle that's taking place. And I would have to imagine, because again, there's no transformation without pain. And I wonder if that caterpillar goes through some pain in that cocoon. And then after a while of struggling, you know, I heard that one time there was a caterpillar in a cocoon, and a little boy came and he opened the cocoon and the caterpillar died. Why? Because the caterpillar needed the struggle of the cocoon. He needed to struggle in that cocoon, and that as he struggled, eventually he emerged as what? A beautiful butterfly. What a transformation. What a transformation. And as I think about that, I'll close with the words of a song. And it goes like this. Once I was a caterpillar, now I am a butterfly. I've been transformed, been reborn, and Jesus is the reason why. Yes, at one point we were caterpillars, crawling across the dust of this earth. But Jesus came. He was born. He lived his life. He died on the cross. He rose again so that we might have eternal life, and that we might be transformed in this life. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be able to look at the joy of being transformed. And truly it is a joy, Lord, to know that we are no longer slave to our sinful desires, that we need not be slaves, Lord, to the evil things that seek to draw us away from you. But Lord, we can live this transformed life and live it in a way that you are pleased and that you are glorified. Father, we pray that if there's someone here today that has never received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, we ask that they might pray this simple prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. And right now, I ask you to come into my life and, Lord, transform me. Be my Lord and Savior, so I might not only have eternal life, but I can have a transformed life right now. And I receive Jesus into my life. Amen. Good to have you with us today. And as always, if you prayed that prayer to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, give us a call here at 412-242-3255. And we will get some information to help you follow up on that decision that you've made. Or maybe you need some information. We can get some literature into your hands to help you follow up on that decision. And if you will call us, leave your name and how we can contact you, then we'll make sure that we'll get you what you need to be to experience that transformation, to become all that Christ would have you to be. God bless you. Thank you for tuning in today.